So one of the questions that I get asked most about is filters. What kind of filters I use and what I recommend. And because filters is one of the areas of my photography that's changed the most since I started, what I want to do in this video is have a look at filters, when I think they're useful, when I think they're absolutely essential, and what kind of filters that I recommend. And we'll probably get a little bit diverted and talk a bit about long exposures, so I hope you can bear with me on that. Now, we have a pretty strict lockdown in Lisbon at the moment, which makes it quite difficult to get out and shoot any B-roll for this video, but hopefully with some old photos and some video archive, then I think we'll manage to get by. So first, let's break down filters into the different kinds. You've got square filters, which attach to a filter holder like this, which screws onto the front of your lens. And usually these can take about two or three filters. Now, square filters come in different sizes, 85 millimeters across, 100 millimeters across, even bigger, 150 millimeters across. And the size of the filters that you're going to use really depends on the size of the sensor that you're using, as well as the focal length that you're using. So for example, if you're shooting on a Micro Four Thirds and you're not shooting ultra wide angle, then something like an 85 millimeter filter is probably going to be enough. If like me, you use an APS-C sensor and you shoot ultra wide, then you're going to need something like 100 millimeter filters, because any smaller than that, and what's going to happen is in the corners of the frame, you're going to be able to start to see the edges of the filter holder, and it's going to give you vignetting. Also, even shooting with 100 millimeter, when you're shooting ultra wide, it's very rare that you're going to be able to attach more than two filters, because again, you're getting vignetting. The corners will start to get really dark. If you shoot with a full frame sensor, you'll probably be okay with also with 100 millimeters. But if you shoot ultra wide, something like the 14 millimeter on a full frame sensor, or even on an APS-C sensor with something like the 8-16, where there's a really protruding front element which is quite bulbous, you'll need the really big filters, the 150 millimeter filters, which attach onto the front of the lens, just to be able to shoot with those and not get vignetting in the corners. Now, square filters come in two different materials. The most common and the cheaper are a kind of plastic resin, which is very light. As I say, it's quite cheap, but one of the problems with those kind of filters for me is that they do scratch very easily. It's very easy to get scratches on the front of the filters, which is going to affect the image quality. The alternative to that is glass. Now, glass for me, it's better. It's more brittle. If you drop them, they're going to smash into lots of pieces, but it doesn't scratch quite so easily. It is a little bit heavier and it is more expensive, but for me, glass, if you're using square filters, glass filters are certainly the way to go. Now, aside from square filters, you've got circular filters, things like this. Now, these just screw directly in the lens. You don't need the filter holder. And you can sometimes stack a couple of these, but again, you have to be very wary of vignetting, because even wide angle, when you have two of these filters together, then the edge starts to come in and you start to notice it in the corners of the frame, again, giving you vignetting. So let's have a look at what you can use filters for. Now, for me, the most useful kind of filters and the ones that I use most often are neutral density filters or ND filters, which are basically just a dark piece of glass like this, which reduce the amount of light passing through the filter and getting onto the sensor, giving you a longer exposure. Now, why would you want to reduce the amount of light and have a longer exposure? What this does is it allows you to create effects with things in the landscape that are moving, things like water, for example. So if you're shooting down by the beach, it allows you to just get a little bit of movement blur in the waves as they come up the beach. If you're shooting a waterfall, it allows you to blur the water. Or if you're shooting the ocean, it gives you the opportunity to get that really long exposure, which gives you that kind of ethereal, milky, misty look in the ocean. All of those are long exposures that are done by cutting the amount of light to give you a long exposure using one of these, an ND filter. Now, ND filters come in square and circular, and they come in different strengths, which is measured by stops, the number of stops of light which they reduce, pretty much from 2 stops all the way up to 15 stops. Now, how strong you want the filter, how strong a filter you use, really depends on what you're shooting, the effect that you're trying to get. So for example, something like a 2 or a 3 stop filter will give you an exposure of something like anything from 0.5 seconds to about 2 seconds, depending on the amount of light that you've got. And an exposure of 0.5 seconds to 2 seconds is really nice for a number of things. For example, if you're shooting the beach, when the water's rushing up the beach, something like about 0.5 seconds to 1 second gives you just a nice amount of blur just in the water. If you're shooting a waterfall, something like 0.5 seconds to 1 second again gives a nice bit of blur in the water, but still allows you to see the power of the waterfall. With a waterfall, if you shoot a really long exposure, something like about 10 seconds, 20 seconds, or even longer, then the water gets incredibly blurry. blurred, you get this really long streaky effects in the water, which for me lose a little bit of the power of the waterfall. But again, this is all personal, it's all an artistic decision that you make. But if you want to get something like half a second to a second, then a filter of about two or three or four stops works really well. I always carry a four-stop filter with me, and I use it a lot when I'm shooting the ocean, and I use it pretty much all the time when I'm shooting waterfalls. And then you've got really long exposures, which for me is anything from about 20 seconds all the way up to about 10 minutes. Now, an exposure like that, what it's going to do if you're shooting water is remove all of the movement from it and turn it to give it that kind of misty, ethereal look, which really depends on how much movement there is in the water. If you're shooting a rough ocean, it's going to look like mist. If the ocean is a lot calmer, it's just going to look very, very flat. Now, again, it really depends on when you're shooting and how much light there is. If you're shooting in the middle of the day, then something like a 15-stop filter is going to give you a long exposure. But if you're shooting a lot in the blue hour, these kind of exposures, which is when I tend to shoot, something like a 6 to a 10-stop exposure is going to give you something in that kind of time. It's very rare that I shoot more than 2 minute exposures of more than 2 minutes, and for that I find that a 10-stop filter is pretty much perfect. Now, exposures of this length can also blur the clouds in the sky, really depending on how much wind there is, how many clouds there are, how fast the clouds are moving. But anything like 30 seconds and you're going to start to see that the clouds will move. And if you do something like 2 minutes and it's a windy day, then the clouds are going to be really streaking across the sky. Now, this can look really nice if you're shooting a very static scene, something in the mountains. For me, I actually like a little bit of definition in the clouds. I like the clouds to be more static. I think if you blur the clouds, it just starts to lose a little bit of that feeling. But there are certain scenes, certain locations when it is a really nice effect and when it does work really well. And one final kind of neutral density filter that you've got are these, which are variable NDs, which have different strengths of filtration, which you get by twisting them around. They basically have two pieces of glass inside them, and as you twist them, then the glasses rotate against each other, giving you different strengths of filtration. Now, these can be nice, but one of the problems that I have with them is that even the ones, well, this one actually has the strength of filtration mark, but it's not always accurate, and many variable NDs don't actually tell you how much filtration you're getting, or if they do, it's not accurate, which makes it very hard to measure the exposure. It can be a little bit hit and miss. Also, with really long exposures, I find that you can get a very uneven light distribution across the scene, which can make some parts of the frame darker than the others. And with many of these, if you turn them to the extreme level of filtration, you get a kind of X across the middle where the two pieces of glass make a very nasty dark mark. And I generally don't really like using them very much. I think basically, in terms of landscape photography, they're quite useful for waterfalls. You can twist around if you want like two or three stops. But overall, I think the variable NDs are best used for video when you're trying to keep a consistent shutter speed and frame rate when you're filming video on bright sunny days.
Now, when we're using ND filters in the field, there are a couple of things that we need to bear in mind. Basically, that's accurately measuring the exposure with the ND filter on, and particularly if you're using a darker filter, accurately measuring the focus of the camera. So if you're using something like a 3 or a 4-stop filter and there's quite a lot of light, then the chances are the camera is going to be able to accurately read the exposure through that. But if you're shooting in the blue hour when the light levels are lower and it's darker, or if you're using a stronger filter, something like a 6-stop or stronger, then what you're going to find is that there's just not enough light getting through onto the sensors, not enough light passing through the filter for the camera to be able to accurately measure the exposure. So it's a really good habit to get into, is to always measure the exposure without the filter, to give yourself a base exposure. And then once you've got that, there are a number of different ways that you can go about measuring what the exposure should be once the filter is attached. Now, some filters actually come with an exposure card where you can look at the base exposure, and then across from that, it's going to tell you exactly how long the shutter speed needs to be. But you can also get the same thing in apps for your phone. So PhotoPills make a really nice app, which you can see here, where you just input the setting, add the filter that you're using, and then it'll give you the shutter speed that you should use once the filter is attached. They also make a really nice one, although this is specific for their filters, so it's only really useful if you have a 6-stop, a 10-stop, or a 15-stop filter. Or if you're old school like me and you don't really like the idea of faffing around with your phone trying to work out exposure in the field, you can basically just work it out in your head, because for each stop of the filter you just need to half the exposure time. So if you're in the field and you're shooting something in the blue hour and your base exposure without the filter is something like 1 over 15 and you want to be using a 10 stop filter, you basically just need to halve 1 over 15 10 times. And if you do that, it's going to give you an exposure time of around a minute, which is what you're going to use once you've got the 10 stop ND filter attached. Now, it's a similar thing with focusing. If you're using a 3 or 4 stop filter and there's plenty of light, the camera is really not going to have any problem using the autofocus. There's going to be enough light getting into the lens for it to be able to do that. You're also going to be able to see perfectly clearly enough to be able to use manual focus. But if you're shooting in the blue hour, or if you're using a stronger filter, quite simply that big dark piece of glass on the front of the lens makes it impossible for you to see through, or impossible for the autofocus to find anything to focus on. So once again, what you need to do is, before you put the filter on, focus the camera, focus it in manual, or use the autofocus and then switch it to manual after you've found the focus, and then put the filter on. And that way you know that with the filter on, the camera already has the focus sorted out. And the last thing to mention when you're doing long exposures with a neutral density filter is to make sure that the camera doesn't move at all when you're doing the exposure. So the first thing that you're going to need is a sturdy tripod, so the camera doesn't move at all, it's not moved by the wind during the exposure. And you also need to be aware that when you release a shutter, when you touch a shutter button, that's also going to nudge the camera. So it's best to use something like a camera remote, a cable release to trip the shutter. Or you can use a 2-second timer, so you press a shutter button and then the camera waits for 2 seconds before taking the image. But if you're shooting somewhere where the timing of the image is particularly important, so for example, if you're shooting next to the ocean and you want to time the waves rushing up the beach or receding down the beach, then doing that with a 2-second timer is pretty much impossible, so you're going to need a cable release. So that's it for neutral density filters, and the next type of filters that I want to talk about are neutral density graduated filters, or ND grads, or graduated NDs. And what these are rectangular filters that work with a filter holder. They slide into a filter holder where the top half of the filter is darkened to reduce the amount of light going into the top half of the filter, but the bottom half of the filter is clear. And the way these work is that the darker part of the filter, where the light's reduced, covers the sky, covers the brighter part of the image. So it's going to reduce the exposure in the sky while leaving the bottom half of the image where it's clear. It's not going to affect the exposure there and allow you to have a wider dynamic range within the camera, capturing the whole scene in one shot. Now, neutral density filters come in different strengths, starting from about 1 stop all the way up to 4 stops. Now, 1 stop filter, it doesn't really make any difference. These are throwbacks to the film days when cameras had a narrower dynamic range than they do now. And if you use a stronger filter, for me personally, if you're using something like a 4-stop filter, that darkens the sky down quite a lot. You'll find that it gets quite dark in the corners. And the thing to remember when you're using neutral density filters is that the sky is always brighter naturally than the ground. So if you darken the sky too much, it starts to look unnatural. So you should always take careful measurements, both of the sky and of the ground, just to try to keep the image natural. I think personally the most useful neutral density graduated filters are 2-stops. 2-stops is about the difference usually between the sky and its reflection in the water. So if you shoot a reflected shot, what you'll find is that the thing and the reflection of the thing are pretty much equal. But again, you always have to be careful to make sure that the sky, that the actual thing, is always brighter than the reflection, or it just starts to look a little bit fake. Now, neutral density filters only come in square graduations because you need to be able to slide them up and down in the filter holder to make sure that the line of graduation is over the horizon. And they come in different graduations. They come in both soft and a hard graduation. A hard graduation has a very sudden transition between the clear part and the darker part of the filter. And these work when you have a very flat horizon. So for example, if you're photographing the sea, and then you also have softer graduations where the transition between the clear part and the darker part is much more gradual. And these tend to work better when you're shooting scenes where the horizon isn't flat. So if you're shooting in a hilly location or something like that. But both of these filters suffer from the problem that if you're shooting anywhere where there is a significant part of the landscape, something like a mountain or something like a sea stack that protrudes above the horizon in front of the sky, that part of the landscape is going to be behind the filter, so it's going to be darkened down in the same way that the sky is. And this can actually be quite problematic and tricky to remove in Photoshop. So an alternative to using neutral density graduated filters, and something that I use much more in my photography, is to bracket images. So basically you can shoot an exposure for the sky and then shoot an exposure for the landscape. And nowadays in Lightroom, you can do this in 2 clicks. All you need to do is select both images, right click, photo merge, HDR merge, make sure that you've unchecked auto settings, and then Lightroom's going to merge both of those images and give you an image file which has a dynamic range. It has all of the data from the highlights and the shadows contained within one image file. So you get a much wider dynamic range within that particular file. Now, I prefer doing this using filters, not only because it gets around the problem of darkening things like mountains, but I also think it just gives me a more natural sky. I find that I'm not getting darkening in the corners of the sky as you do from strong graduated filters because of the light fall off. And another advantage of it means that I don't need to carry things like the filter holder and the square filters. So I save a little bit of space in my backpack and it's a little bit lighter. Now, one thing to be aware of when you're using neutral density filters, both straight ND filters and also grads, is color casts and changes in white balance, because neutral density filters cut out the light, but what sometimes happens is they don't cut out the light equally all the way across the spectrum. So you find that some colors can be stronger than others, which can lead to color cast tints. You can get something a little bit more magenta, it can cool down the image too much, you can get a green tint, it can make it too warm. Now, this can often be corrected in post-processing in Lightroom, but sometimes it's a little bit complex, so it's better to get the best quality filters that you can, which have less of a color cast. Now, I use Polar Pro quartz line filters for my ND filters, and I found that even up to 10 stops, they don't really have any color cast whatsoever. And when it comes to graduated filters, I always found that Lee and Nissi filters were both really good quality. Now, the final category of filters that I want to talk about are polarizing filters. And the way that polarizing filters work is that they remove the glare that you get when light is reflected from the surface of things like glass or water in the landscape. So what you can find is, if you're shooting down by the ocean, as the light's coming in, you get lots of specular highlights where the sunlight's bouncing off the waves or the wet rocks. It's the same if you're shooting a waterfall or a river. The highlights can be really, really strong. And just by using a circular polarizer, by twisting the filter and polarizing it, you can cut that glare out completely. They also work to totally remove the reflections. Now, it would be really nice if I could show you this by going next to a lake or some still water like that, and you can twist the polarizer and cut off the reflection from the water so you can actually see what's underneath the water. But because I'm on lockdown, I have to make do by showing you how much it can remove the reflection from the glass in my living room. Just by twisting the polarizer, you can see it completely cuts out the reflection and we start to see through the glass, and that's exactly the same when you use it on still water. And another thing that polarizers do really nicely is removing haze from a landscape. So they're particularly useful if you're shooting in the mountains, if you're shooting a telephoto scene and things are quite far away and there's a little bit of haze. By using a polarizing filter, what you can do is just twist it and cut through the haze, remove the haze, and it will give you a much clearer, the details are going to start to pop a little bit more, it's going to feel a little bit more saturated and a little bit more contrasted in the image. However, one thing that you need to be aware of with polarizers is that if you're shooting on a clear day, particularly if you're shooting at about 90 degrees from the sun, they'll make the skies go a really nice deep blue and they'll really make the white clouds pop out. But if you're shooting with an ultra wide angle lens, the polarizing effect isn't going to be the same all the way across the image. So you'll find that you get these really dark patches in parts of the sky which are really hard to remove in Photoshop and look very unnatural. So for me, when I'm using a polarizing lens, I tend to not use them if I'm shooting in bright light with a wide angle. I find them really useful for shooting inside forests, for shooting waterfalls, things like that, and it's something that I always have with me. But like all filters, they're not something that can be used all the time. You need to choose when you're going to use it. And the last thing to say about filters is that most people have a range of lenses of different sizes with different diameters and different size filter threads, and obviously you only want to buy one set of filters. So the best thing to do is to buy filters that fit your largest lens, and then for all your other lens, you just get step-up rings like this, which you can screw onto the front of the lens, and then we'll then take a different size filter to the actual lens. These are super cheap, they cost a few dollars or a few euros, and I've got one of these for each of my lenses. Now, my largest lens is 72 millimeters in diameter, but the filters that I use, Polar Pro Quartz Line, are all 77 millimeters, so I actually have a step-up ring on every single one of my lenses. And so what filters do you actually need to carry with you all the time? Now, this really depends on your shooting style, how you like to shoot. A lot of people like graduated neutral density filters because they like to get the whole scene in one shot. Now, over years, I've changed the way that I shoot a bit. I always used to have graduated neutral density filters with me, but I simply don't carry them with me anymore. more. Now basically all of my filters are in here. I only take three filters with me wherever I go. I take a 10-stop neutral density filter if I want to make really long exposures. I take a 4-stop neutral density filter, which is great for shooting the coast, getting a little bit of blur in the waves, great if I'm shooting waterfalls, and I take a polarizer with me. And that's it, that's all I find that I need. But as I say, it's different for different people, and a lot of people like to have filters for every eventuality. Personally for me, I like to keep things as simple as possible, and over the years that I've been shooting, I found that those three filters are all that I need. And so I think that's it for this video. Thanks for watching, and if you enjoyed my photography and you'd like to join me on a workshop this year, I still have a few places left on workshops that I'm going to be doing later in this year. I'm going to be heading to Lofoten in June. We're going to be doing a lot of hiking up to the tops of the mountains for the midnight sun. And I'm also going to be doing a workshop in the Dolomites in spring, and also in Tuscany. So if you're interested, check out my website. There's lots more information there. I'm also going to be launching some incredible trips for next year, so check out the website, and I'd love to have you join me for an adventure. And once again, thanks so much for watching. I hope it's been interesting, and I hope it's been useful. If you've got any questions at all, just drop me a comment in the box below or send me an email, and I'll get back to you. Take care, stay safe, and good luck with your photography.